You've got them mixed up. You're making a mistake. You're making a mistake with a reindeer. Would you mind stepping out for a moment? Open the door.
I'm sorry, the store isn't open today.
I don't want to blame anything, and I'm sorry to interrupt you in your work. But I wanted to tell you you're making a rather serious mistake.
Huh?
With the reindeer, I mean. You've got Cupid where Blitzen should be. And Dasher, should be on my right-hand side.
You sure that?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, another thing. Donna's antlers have got 4 points instead of 3.
Still, I don't suppose anybody had noticed that except myself.
No, I don't suppose so. Well, bye.
Not at all.
Thanks.
Glad to help you.
Bye.
Done. 3 men in a tub float. Just as clean enough. We can get the butcher and the baker in, but the
car... I'm awfully sorry, Mr. Shellhammer, but I've got enough to do to take care of the
people. Dear, I was so hoping that you... George!
Is that so?
Yes, it's just like throwing a ball.
If you would...
You've been drinking.
It's cold. A man's got to do something to keep warm.
You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Don't you realize there are thousands of children lining the streets waiting to see you? Children have been dreaming of this moment for weeks. You're a disgrace to the tradition of Christmas, and I refuse to have you malign me in this fashion.
Tell me, who's in charge of this parade? When you find out, you tell me. These pants are going to fall off in the middle of Columbus Circle.
I beg your pardon. Could you tell me who's in charge here?
Yes, Mrs. Walker. There she is down there.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, you two ought to be over on 81st.
Mr. Walker, one of the men in your parade is not fit to receive...
What are you doing out of costume? Now get back and get dressed. Oh, I'm terribly sorry. I thought you were our Santa Claus.
Your Santa Claus is intoxicated.
Oh, no!
Yes, it's disgraceful.
How can you allow a man to get such a...
What do you mean by drinking? You know it's not allowed.
A man's cold. A man's got to do something to keep warm.
I'll warm you. I ought to take this cane and...
And I ought to... somebody, Judy, and get some black coffee. Plenty of it.
Yes,
black with a little cream. Wake me up when the plate starts. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells.
Absolutely shameful.
Could you be Santa Claus? Have you had any experience?
Oh, a little.
Oh, please, you've got to help me out.
Madam, I am not in the habit of substituting for spurious Santa Clauses. No.
Oh, please.
Well,
The children mustn't be disappointed. All right, I'll do it.
Oh, God, thank you. Come on, right this way. Get that coffee.
I'm glad he was there.
Just think if Mr. Macy had seen the other one.
Just think if Mr. Gimble had seen the other one.
You want to ride the motorcycle or a car?
No, I'm going to go home and get in a hot tub, and I might stay there until next Thanksgiving.
Oh, you really should see the parade you worked so hard on.
Oh, if I want to, which I doubt. I can see it from the roof of my apartment.
Well, that's right. You live down there.
Mrs. Walker!
Susan, when he asked me, well, I didn't think you'd mind.
Well, I guess it's all right. I'll go on in a minute.
Looks like they're having a little trouble with the baseball player.
He was a clown last year. They just changed the head and painted him different. My mother told me.
He certainly is a giant, isn't he?
Not really. There are no giants, Mr. Gailey.
Maybe not now, Susie, but in olden days there were a lot of... Well, what about the giant that Jack killed?
Jack? Jack who?
Jack. Jack. Jack and the Beanstalk.
I never heard of that.
You must have heard of that. You've just forgotten. It's a fairy tale.
Oh, one of those. I don't know any fairy tales.
Oh, your mother and father must have told you a fairy tale.
No, my mother thinks they're silly. I don't know whether my father thinks they're silly or not. I never met my father. You see, my father and mother were divorced when I was a baby.
Well, that baseball player certainly looks like a giant to me.
People sometimes grow very big, but that's abnormal.
I'll bet your mother told you that, too.
Hello. I'm Susan's mother.
Yes, I know. Won't you come in? Susie's told me quite a lot about you. I'm Frank Haley.
Yes, I know. Susan's told me quite a lot about you, too.
Hello, Mother.
Hello, dear.
Oh. Won't you have a cup of coffee? You must be half frozen standing.
Oh, don't bother.
Oh, it's no bother, it's already.
Well, in that case, thanks. What do you think of my parade?
It's much better than last year's.
Well, I hope Mr. Macy agrees with you.
Sure, cream, both, neither?
Just one sugar, please. This is very kind of you, Mr. Gailey.
Sit down.
I don't want to thank you for being so kind to Susan. Leo tells me that you took them to the zoo yesterday.
That's right. But I must confess it's part of a deep-dyed plot. I'm fond of Susie, very fond. But I also want to meet you. I read someplace that the surest way to meet the mother is to be kind to the child.
What a horrible trick.
It worked.
There goes Santa Claus.
Don't even mention the name.
He's much better than last year's. At least this one doesn't wear glasses.
This one was a last-minute substitute. The one I hired, I fired.
Why?
You remember the way the janitor was last New Year's?
Oh, yes.
Well, this one was much worse.
Oh. I see she doesn't believe in Santa Claus either. No Santa Claus, no fairy tales. No fantasies of any kind. Is that it?
That's right. I think we should be realistic and completely truthful with our children and not have them growing up believing in a lot of legends and myths like Santa Claus, for example.
That's the end. The acrobats were good.
They ought to be at those prices. Thanks for the coffee.
And thank you for inviting me in.
It was a pleasure, Missy.
Mother, I was thinking, we've got such a big turkey for dinner, and there are only two of us. Couldn't we invite Mr. Gailey? Couldn't we?
Well...
Oh, don't even think about it. I'll have a sandwich or something.
It's an awful big turkey.
That's not it, dear, but I'm sure Mr. Gailey has other plans.
No, he hasn't. Have you?
To be... quite honest and truthful with the child. I must admit I haven't any other plans.
Please, Mother, please.
Well,
did I ask all right? Didn't I ask all right, Mr. Gailey?
That all depends.
Dinner's at 3.
Thanks. Susie, honey, you asked just right. I'll see you at 3.
I tell you, Mrs. Walker, he's stupendous. Everybody's crazy about him. So is Mr. Macy.
Well, hire him by all means. It's perfectly all right with me. As a matter of fact, it'll save me a frantic search in the morning. Yes, that's right.
All right, I'll take care of it as soon as he gets through. Oh, you'll love him. I just know that with that man on the throne, my department will sell more toys than it ever has. He's a born salesman. I just feel it.
Yes, yes, yes. We'll talk about it in the morning. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
And you'll find toys of all kinds at Macy's.
Sure is an elegant costume.
Yes. I've had it for years. And years.
Sure makes a bum out of the one they hate. But even that one's better than the one I wear.
You are?
Yeah, I play Santa Claus over at the line near our block, see?
No kidding.
Started about 3 years ago. They had a costume, but, well, it didn't have no padding in it. Since I carry my own padding around with me, I cut the job, see?
You enjoy impersonating me?
Oh, yeah.
Why?
I don't know. It's when I give packages to little kids, I like to watch their faces get that Christmas look all of a sudden. It makes me feel kind of good and important.
Striking costume. Before you go up on the floor, I just want to give you a few tips on how to be a good Santa Claus.
Go right ahead. Here's a list of toys that we have to push. You know, things that we're overstocked on.
Now, you'll find that a great many children will be undecided as to what they want for Christmas. When that happens, you immediately suggest one of these items. You understand?
I certainly do.
Good. Now, you memorize that list, and I'll... I'll tell you. When you've finished, come up to the seventh floor. I'll be waiting for you.
Imagine. Making a child take something it doesn't want just because he bought too many of the wrong toys. That's what I've been fighting against for years, the way they commercialize Christmas.
Yeah, there's a lot of bad isms floating around this world, but one of the worst is commercialism. Make a buck, make a buck. Even in Brooklyn, it's the same. Don't care what Christmas stands for, just make a buck, make a buck. Oh, don't bother, I'll come away with you.
Huh? Oh, thank you, Humphrey. What should I do with these?
Throw them on a floor. I get kind of tired just sweeping up dust.
Uh-oh.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Humphrey. Yes, yes. Peter's a fine name. What do you want for Christmas, Peter?
I want a fine just like the big ones. Only smaller, it has rolls. It's going to throw out water, and I won't do it in the house. I'll only do it in the backyard. I promise.
Macy's ain't got me. Nobody's got me.
Well, Peter, I can tell you're a good boy. You'll get your fire engine.
Oh, thank you very much. You see? I told you he'd get me one.
That's fine. That's just dandy. Listen, you wait over there. Mama wants to thank Santa Claus, too. Say, listen, what's the matter with you? Don't you understand English? I tell you, Macy's ain't got me. Nobody's got me. I've been all over. My feet are killing me. Fine thing, promising the kid.
Now, you don't think I would have said that unless I was sure, do you? You can get those fire engines. At Schoenfeld's on Lexington Avenue. Only $8.50, a wonderful bargain.
Schoenfeld's? I don't get it.
Oh, I keep track of the toy market pretty closely. Does that surprise you, sir?
Surprise me? Macy, sending people to the store. Are you kidding me?
Well, the only important thing is to make the children happy. Whether Macy or somebody else sells a toy doesn't make any difference. Don't you feel that way?
Huh? Oh, me? Oh, yeah, sure. Well, I didn't know Macy's did.
Well, as long as I'm here, they do.
I don't get it. No? I just don't get it.
Like some skates, but of course you must get all the best, because they're little ankles, you know, they want protecting. Now, we've got skates, they're very good, too, but they're not quite good enough. You've got to give them, they'll have exactly what you're looking for, I'm sure.
There you are.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, that's for you.
Merry Christmas.
Tomorrow. Hello, my
Henry, the guard said I should speak to you. You're the head of the toy department, huh?
Yes, madam, but at the moment
Well, listen, I want to congratulate you and Macy's on this wonderful new stunt you're pulling. Imagine sending people to other stores. I don't get it. Why, it
certainly is.
You said it. Imagine a big outfit like Macy's putting the spirit of Christmas ahead of the commercial. It's wonderful. Well, I'll tell you, I never done much shopping here before, but I'll tell you one thing. From now on, I'm going to be a regular Macy customer. All right.
Thank you, ma'am.
There are six more women out there who want to thank you.
Not now. I've got to think this thing over.
Well, personally, I think it's a wonderful idea, too.
You think so? Those women think so. The point is, will Mr. Macy think so?
This seems awfully silly, Mr. Daly.
I thought as long as we're in the store, you might as well say hello to Santa Claus.
Why?
Because when you talk to him, you might feel differently about it.
Now, Merry Christmas. Well, young lady, what's your name?
Susan Walker. What's yours?
Mine? Kris Kringle. I'm Santa Claus. Oh, you don't believe that, do you?
Mm-mm. You see, my mother's Mrs. Walker, the lady who hired you. But I must say, you're the best looking one I've ever seen.
Really?
Your beard doesn't have one of those things that goes over your ears.
Well, that's because it's real. Just like I'm really Santa Claus. Oh, go ahead. Pull it.
All right, boys. Don't crowd. You have all day to see Santa Claus. Now, chill and behave. Just wait, please. Get back in the line now.
And now, what would you like me to bring you for Christmas?
Nothing, thank you.
Oh, come now, you must want something.
Whatever I want, my mother will get for me. If it's sensible and doesn't cost too much, of course. Hello, Mother.
Hello, Susan. Hello, Mr. Daly. I think you've taken up enough with this gentleman's time now. Come along, dear.
The explanation for this is all very simple. Cleo's mother sprained her ankle. She had to go home, so she asked me to bring Susie down to you.
Yes, I know. Cleo called me. I was wondering where you were.
Well, I thought as long as we were here, we might as well say hello to Santa Claus.
He's a nice old man, Mother. And those whiskers are real, too.
Yes, yes, dear. Many men have long beards like that. Susan, would you stand over here a minute? I want to talk to Mr. Daly.
I shouldn't have brought Susie to see Santa Claus, huh?
Now you're making me feel like the proverbial stepmother.
Well, I'm sorry, but it's just that I couldn't see any harm in just saying hello to the old fellow.
But I think there is harm. I tell her Santa Claus is a myth, and you bring her down here, and she sees hundreds of gullible children, meets a very convincing old man with real whiskers. This sets up a very harmful mental conflict within her. What is she going to think? Who is she going to believe? And by filling them full of fairy tales, they grow up considering life a fantasy instead of a reality. They keep waiting for Prince Charming to come along. When he does, he turns out to be a...
We were talking about Susie, not about you.
Well, whether you agree or not, I must ask you to respect my wishes regarding Susan. She's my responsibility, and I must bring her up as I see fit.
Okay.
Say thank you, Santa Claus.
Thank you.
Bye. Merry Christmas. Well, young lady, what's your name?
I'm sorry, she doesn't speak English. She's Dutch. She just came over. She's been living in an orphan's home in Rotterdam ever since... Well, we've adopted her. I told her you wouldn't be able to speak to her, but when she saw you in the parade yesterday, she said you were Santa Claus, as she calls you, and you could talk to her. Well, I didn't know what to do.
Hello. Ich bin blij dat je gekomen bent.
Oh, Ben Santa Claus.
Hi, yes, Zeker.
Mr. Bell, it was Zeker that you had Zabelgreifen.
Natürlich. Sag mal, was ist so will in heaven, Ben Santa Claus?
Nichts. Ich kann von alles. Ich will allein mal bei Daisy Lee für Dame sein.
Will ihr mal nur mehr singen?
Santa Claus, kapuntja. Geef het in mijn schoentje, geef het in mijn laarsje. Dank u, Sinterklaasje. Sinterklaas kapoensje, geef wat in mijn schoentje, geef wat in mijn laarsje. Dank u, Sinterklaasje.
Now do you understand?
Yes, I see what you mean, Mother.
Good.
But when he spoke Dutch to that girl, he was so...
Susan, I speak French, but that doesn't make me Joan of Arc. What I'm trying to explain to you is, come in.
You said you wanted to see me, Mrs. Walker.
Come right in.
Hello. Good to see you again.
It's nice to see you.
You're awfully lucky, Mrs. Walker. Lovely little girl you have here.
Thank you. And Susan's the reason I asked you to drop down. She's a little confused, and I thought maybe you could help to straighten her out.
I'd be glad to.
Would you please tell her that you're not really Santa Claus? That there actually is no such person?
Well, I'm sorry to disagree with you, Mrs. Walker, but not only is there such a person, but here I am to prove it.
No. You misunderstand. I want you to tell her the truth. What's your name?
Chris Kringle.
I'll bet you're in the first grade.
Second.
I mean your real name.
That is my real name.
Second grade?
It's a progressive school.
Oh, it's a progressive school.
May I have this gentleman's employment card, please? Yes, Mrs. Walker.
This dress is very cute. Where did you get such a lovely outfit?
Here at Macy's. We get 10% off.
Please don't feel that you have to keep pretending for Susan's benefit. She's a very intelligent child and always wants to know the absolute truth.
Good, because I always tell the absolute truth. Now, about your school, what's the name of your teacher?
Mrs. Haley.
Mrs. Haley.
Here it is, Mrs. Walker. Thank you.
What else do you do besides read and play games?
We have
recipes.
1/2 hour.
Oh, I don't suppose you care for that.
We're not allowed to talk or anything. Tuesday, Chester Richards, he kept talking all the time.
My, that was bad.
Yes, Mrs. Haney made him stay resting all alone for nearly an hour.
Susan, dear, would you go out and talk to Miss Adams for a minute and I'll be right with you?
All right. Goodbye.
Goodbye, young lady. Hope to see you again.
Thank you. I hope so, too. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
I'm sorry, Mr.
Kringle.
I'm sorry, but we're going to have to make a change.
Change?
The Santa Claus that we had 2 years ago is back in town, and I feel that we owe it to
him. Have I done something wrong?
Oh, no. Yes.
Mr. Macy wants to see you immediately.
I'll be right up. Would you sit down and I'll be right back and sign your pay voucher.
Yes, indeed. Oh, go right in. Mr. Macy's waiting. No.
The effect that this will have on the public is... Oh, come in, Mrs. Walker. Hello, Mrs. Walker.
Hello, Mrs. Walker. I see.
Sit over here. I have just been telling these gentlemen of the new policy you and Mr. Shellhammer initiated. I can't say that I approve of your not consulting the advertising department first, but in the face of this tremendous response on the part of the public, I can't be angry with you. Now to continue, gentlemen. I admit that on the face of it, this plan sounds idiotic and impossible. Imagine Macy's Santa Claus sending customers to Gimbel's. Oh, but gentlemen, you cannot argue with success. Look at this. Telegrams, messages, telephone calls, the governor's wife, the mayor's wife, over 500 thankful parents expressing undying gratitude to Macy's. Never in my entire career have I seen such a tremendous and immediate response to a merchandising policy. And I'm positive, Frank, that if we expand our policy, we'll expand our results as well. Therefore, from now on, not only will our Santa Claus continue in this manner, but I want every salesperson in this store to do precisely the same thing. If we haven't got exactly what the customer wants, we'll send him where he can get it. No high pressuring and forcing a customer to take something he doesn't really want.
But after all, Mr.
We'll be known as the helpful store, the friendly store, the store with a heart, the store that places public service ahead of profit. And consequently, we'll make more profits than ever before. Oh, yes, I know it's late, and we're all tired. We want to go to dinner, so we'll continue the first thing in the morning. In the meantime, you fellas get together and figure out the best way to promote this thing.
We'll do that. Good night, all right.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night, Eric.
Good night. Good night. I want to thank you two again, and in your Christmas envelopes, you'll find a more practical expression of my gratitude.
Thank you, Mr. Macy.
And tell that Santa Claus I won't forget him either.
Yes, Mr. Macy.
Imagine a bonus.
He just assumed it was our idea, so I didn't... What's the matter?
I fired him.
Who?
Santa Claus.
What?
He's crazy. He thinks he is Santa Claus.
Why, I don't care if he thinks he's the Easter Bunny. You've got to get him back.
He's insane, I tell you. We'll just have to hire somebody else and have him do the same thing.
Oh, no. No, you heard what Mr. Macy said. We've got to keep him.
But what if he should have a sudden fit or something? Oh, no, no. I've got to tell Mr. Macy.
But maybe he's only a little crazy, like painters or composers or some of those men in Washington. We can't be sure until he's been examined. If you fire him, and then we find out that he wasn't really crazy, Mr. Macy will have us examined and fired.
I suppose we ought to be sure. We could have Mr. Sawyer talk to him.
Of course. He's a psychologist. That's what he's paid for, to examine employees. Now, until we get his report, we won't say a word.
I'll get in touch with him right away.
Yeah, but first, get that Santa Claus back. The examination won't be worth a thing without the patient.
It was just because I felt that we owed it to him, but Mr. Macy suggested that we find something else for the other Santa Claus and keep you on by all means.
Oh, well, thanks. That's mighty good news. Yes.
You'll be here in the morning, then?
Certainly I will. You see, Mrs. Walker, this is quite an opportunity for me. For the past 50 years or so, I've been getting more and more worried about Christmas. Seems we're all so busy trying to beat the other fellow in making things go faster and look shinier and cost less that Christmas and I are sort of getting lost in the shuffle.
Oh, I don't think so. Christmas is still Christmas.
Oh, Christmas isn't just a day. It's a frame of mind. And that's what's been changing. That's why I'm glad I'm here. Maybe I can do something about it. And I'm glad I met you and your daughter. You two are a test case for me.
We are?
Yes, you're sort of the whole thing in miniature. If I can win you over, there's still hope. If not, then I guess I'm through. But I'm warning you, I don't give up easily. Good night.
Good night. Oh, Mr. Kringle.
Yeah?
The first thing in the morning, would you report to Mr. Sawyer's office?
Sawyer?
Yes, he'll just give you a little examination. Oh, we do it with all our employees.
A mental examination? I don't mind. I've taken dozens of them. Never failed one yet. Know them by heart.
How many days in the week?
7.
How many fingers do you see?
4.
Muscular coordination test.
No damage to the nervous system. Who was the first president of the United States? George Washington. Who was the vice president under John Quincy Adams? Daniel D. Tompkins. And I'll bet your Mr. Sawyer doesn't know that. Good night.
Miss Adams, would you get me the Brooks Memorial Home in Great Neck? It's a home for old people. That's right. I want to talk to the doctor in charge.
How many days in a week?
7.
Who was the first president of the United States?
George Washington.
How much? 3 times 5?
Well, you asked me that before. You'll find the answer right there at the bottom of the...
I'm conducting this examination. How much is 3 times 5?
The same as it was before. 15. You're rather nervous, aren't you, Mr. Sawyer? Do you get enough sleep?
My personal habits are no concern to you.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's just that I hate to see someone tied up.
How many fingers do you see?
3. Oh, you bite your nails, too.
Now, I want you to stand with your feet together and your arms extended. Then I want you to...
Muscular coordination test? Surely. Be glad to. You know, sometimes the cause of nervous habits like yours is not obvious. No. Often they're the result of an insecurity. Are you happy at home, Mr. Sawyer?
That will be all, Mr. Kringle. The examination's over. You may go.
Thank you.
You may go out that way. And it may interest you to know that I've been happily married for 26 years.
Really? Delighted to hear it.
Goodbye. Get me Mrs. Walker.
Yes, sir. And your wife's on 672. She says it's very important.
Agnes, how many times have I told you not to bother me at the office? No, not a penny. I give you a liberal allowance, and it's up to you to run the house on it. If that fat, stupid brother of yours would get a job, you wouldn't have to be pestering me all the time. Mrs. Walker, I'd like to talk to you right away about this Kringle fellow.
Oh, yes. Dr. Pierce from the Brooks home is here and would be a good time to settle the whole matter. Sorry, Doctor, but that was Mr. Sawyer, the gentleman I was telling you about.
Oh, yes.
He'd be right in. He's just down the hall. I can't tell you how we appreciate your giving us your time, Doctor.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, I was going to call you today. I had a feeling along about now you people would be wondering about Chris.
Oh, Dr. Pierce, Mr. Sawyer.
How do you do? Mrs. Walker, after giving this man a comprehensive examination, it's my considered opinion he should be dismissed immediately.
Really? He failed to pass the examination?
Yes.
He didn't answer the questions correctly?
Well, yes, he did, but there was complete lack of concentration. He kept changing the subject. He was even questioning me. I don't think there's any doubt about it. He should be placed in a mental institution.
Oh, I don't agree, Mr. Sawyer. People are only institutionalized to prevent them from harming themselves or other people. Now, Mr. Kringle is incapable of either. His is a delusion for good. He only wants to be friendly and helpful.
That's what I feel, too.
Why, there are thousands of people walking around with similar delusions, living perfectly normal lives in every other respect. A famous example is that fellow, I can't think of his name, but for years he's insisted he's a Russian prince. Now, there's been all kinds of evidence to prove him wrong, but nothing has shaken his story. Is he in an institution? No. He owns a famous restaurant in Hollywood and is a highly respected citizen.
Dr. Pierce, I've made a great study of abnormal psychology, and I've found from experience that when a fixed delusion is challenged, the deluded is apt to become violent.
I'm afraid I'll have to disagree with you again, Mr. Sawyer.
But
if you tell Chris there is no Santa Claus, I grant you he'll argue the point, but he'll not become violent.
His whole manner suggests aggressiveness. Look at the way he carries that cane. And he's never without it.
Well, I know Chris always carries a cane, but surely you're not implying he'd use the cane as a weapon.
Mrs. Walker, naturally I can't discharge this man. That's up to you. But you ask for my opinion, and I've given it to you. So when he exhibits his latent maniacal tendencies, which I assure you he will, please realize the responsibility is completely yours.
Speaking of delusions...
Now we're right back where we started.
No, we're not. After listening to Dr. Pierce, I feel perfectly confident.
Yes, but if anything happens, you won't get blamed. I will.
Mrs. Walker, nothing's going to happen. And please don't feel that what I have said was prompted by my affection for Chris. My specialty is geriatrics.
Huh?
The treatment of the diseases of old age. I've had quite a bit of experience, and I assure you, Chris has no latent maniacal tendencies. Well, you'll probably want to discuss this with Mr. Shellhammer, so I'll be on my way. May I see Chris?
Why, certainly, Doctor. Use the employee's elevator. It's much quicker.
It's the same one you came up.
Well, now, where is that? I'm a little twisted.
I'll show you, Doctor.
That isn't necessary. I'll find my way.
You understand my position, Doctor. If there's the slightest possibility of his becoming violent or getting into any trouble, I could...
What possible trouble could he get into?
All that's got to happen is for a policeman to ask him his name. A big argument? Clang, clang, Bellevue.
Well, you can prevent that very simply. There must be someone here at the store who could rent a room out to him. Then they could both ride to and from work together. I just assumed he didn't take that long train ride out to Great Neck twice a day.
That would solve everything. If someone was with him, they could steer him away from any trouble.
You mean sort of take custody of him? Do you think he'd agree to that?
I'll talk to him. I'm sure he will.
In that case, he can stay.
Good. Thank you.
It's the seventh floor, Doctor, and thank you very much.
Bye, Doctor.
Bye.
Well, sure you've made a wise decision. Now, let's see. Who could rent him a room?
You?
Well,
your son's away at school. What about his room?
Well, I don't mind. I'd be glad to. But I'm positive Mrs. Shellhammer wouldn't like it. She's a little... Say, I have an idea. We always have martinis before dinner. I'll make them double strength tonight. I'll bet after a couple of them, she'll be more receptive to the idea.
But Chris is through work at 6 o'clock. What about the in-between time?
You take him home to dinner, and I'll call you as soon as my wife's plaster... feeling again.
Oh, no,
now, I'm... Really, Mrs. Walker, if I am willing to let my wife have a big headache in the morning, the least you can do is to have a little headache tonight.
All right.
Don't take about an hour or so, but that time everything will be quite all right.
Oh, good. Very good. But what sort of games do you play with the other children in the apartment building here?
I don't play much with them. They play silly games.
They do?
Like today, they were in the basement playing zoo and all of them were animals. When I came down, Homer, he was supposed to be the zookeeper, he said, "What kind of an animal are you?" And I said, "I'm not an animal, I'm a girl." And he said, "Only animals allowed here, goodbye." So he came upstairs.
Why didn't you tell him you were a lion or a bear?
Because I'm not a bear or a lion.
But the other children were only children, and they were pretending to be animals.
But that's what makes the game so silly.
Oh, I don't think so. Sounds like a wonderful game to me. Of course, in order to play it, you've got to have an imagination. Do you know what the imagination is?
Oh, sure. That's when you see things, but they're not really there.
Well, that can be caused by other things, too. No, to me, the imagination is a place all by itself, a separate country. Now, you've heard of the French nation, the British nation. Well, this is the imagination. It's a wonderful place. How would you like to be able to make snowballs in the summertime, eh? Or drive a great big bus right down Fifth Avenue? How would you like to have a ship all to yourself that makes daily trips to China and Australia? How would you like to be the Statue of Liberty in the morning and in the afternoon fly south with a flock of geese? It's very simple. Of course, it takes practice. Now, the first thing you've got to learn is how to pretend. And the next time Homer says, "What kind of animal are you?" you tell him you're a monkey.
But I don't know how to be a monkey.
Sure you do. Here, I'll show you. Now, just bend your body over a little like that. Let your arms hang loose, see? Now, put your right hand up here, under here. That's right. Now, scratch yourself, see? That's right. Now then, put it down under your lip, over your teeth. Now then, scratch yourself and check it, see?
On the contrary, Haslip, Sherman, McKinsley, and Haslip have been very kind to me. But being an exceptional lawyer, I want to open my own office.
Could you put this in Susan's place for me, please?
I think you can take my need out of it. Should be done.
Don't forget to scratch yourself. Put your tongue up in front of the
teacher.
Don't do the other monkeys.
What's going on here?
Oh. We're just having our first lesson in pretending. Oh, doing quite well at it, too. Now, that's right. Go on now. Call the other monkeys in front of the teacher. Now, you're a goose. No, you mustn't be a goose. Be a monkey.
Scratch. Mr. Kringle. Yeah? Mrs. Walker just happened to mention that they're looking for a room for you here in town.
That's right. Dr. Pierce doesn't want me to make that long trip every day.
Well, I was just thinking, I'm all alone in my apartment. Twin beds, plenty of room. If you'd like to move in with me, I'd be only too happy to have you.
Well, that's awfully nice of you.
You could ride to and from work every day with Mrs. Walker.
Yes. Give me a chance to really talk things over with her. Don't forget to scratch. You're not scratching. You're not. Besides, I can see Susie now and then. Mr. Gailey, it's a deal.
Sure. We'll drive on up to dinner and get your things.
Hey.
Hello? Oh, yes, just a moment. It's a Mr. Shellhammer.
Thanks. Hello? Hello, Mr. Shellhammer.
Yes, just a moment. Mrs. Shellhammer wants to talk to you. I
have made the martinis triple strength, and she feels wonderful.
Hello? Hello?
No. No, dear.
Thank you, darling. Hello?
No, dear.
Oh, darling. How silly of me. Hello? Why, we'd love to have Santa Claus come and stay with us. I think it would be simply charming.
Oh, and so do I, Mrs. Shellhammer. Just a moment. It's Mrs. Shellhammer, and they have the loveliest room, and they'd be so happy if you'd stay with them.
That's very sweet of them. Please thank them very much, but I'm going to stay with Mr. Gailey.
Mr. Gailey?
I think I'd better get to meet. Yes, I understand that, but there must be something you want for Christmas, something you haven't even told your mother about, eh? Oh, come on now. Why don't you give me a chance?
That's what I want for Christmas.
You mean a doll's house like this?
No, a real house. If you're really Santa Claus, you can get it for me. And if you can't, you're only a nice man with a white beard like Mother said.
Now, wait a minute, Susie. Just because every child can't get his wish, that doesn't mean there isn't a Santa Claus.
That's what I thought you'd say.
No, but don't you see, dear? Some children wish for things they couldn't possibly use, like real locomotives or B-29s.
But this isn't like a locomotive or a B-29.
It's awful big for a little girl like you. What could you possibly do with a house like this?
Live in it with my mother.
But you've got this lovely apartment.
I don't think it's lovely. I want a backyard with a great big tree to put a swing on it. I guess you can't get it, huh?
I didn't say that. It's a tall order. Well, I'll do my best. May I keep this picture?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Good night, sir.
Good night, Mr. Crinkle.
You got here?
Oh, well, I'm lucky to get it.
You, like living in Manhattan?
Oh, it's all right. Of course, someday I'd like to get a place on Long Island. Not a big house, just one of those junior partner deals around Manhattan.
I know just the kind of place you mean. One of those little, colonial houses.
Well, either that or Cape Cod.
You know, I think you're right about Mrs. Walker. A little more effort on your part, and she might crawl out of that shell and take her out to dinner in the theater.
I've tried that. She's always too busy with her job.
Well, try a little harder. Those two are a couple of lost souls, and it's up to us to help you. I'll take care of Susie if you'll take care of her mother.
It's a deal.
Ready?
Oh, no, you don't. I'm not going to be cheated this way. All my life I've wondered something, and now's my chance to find out. I'm going to find the answer to a question that's puzzled the world for centuries. Does Santa Claus sleep with his whiskers outside or in?
Always sleeping them out. Cold air makes them grow.
Joe, we're running out of books.
I'll get some for you right away.
And I need more Rod Makers.
But I think Gimbel's does. Let me see. Yes, here it is. I thought I noticed it before. $2.98. Looks like an exceptional bargain.
Yes, yes, it does. Thank you.
Not at all. Not at all.
And why didn't one of you think of this idea? It's the greatest goodwill policy I ever heard of. Every shopper in New York City suddenly thinks of Macy as a benevolent soul, thinking only of the welfare of the public. And what does that make Gimbel? Nothing but a profiteering money grubber. Well, two can play at this game. From now on, if we haven't got what the customer wants, send him back to Macy's. And what's more, we'll do the same thing in our stores in Philadelphia, Milwaukee, and Pittsburgh. I get to work on it right away.
So, Gimbel's doing it in Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, and Milwaukee, eh?
Yes, and very successfully.
Well, we can cover the country, too. Notify our stores in San Francisco, Atlanta, Toledo, and Newark to get going right away.
All right, right. Mr. Macy.
This way, Mr. Gimbel. Hold it, Mr. Gimbel.
Now we'll take some at my store.
Just a minute. I have something I'd like to give our friend here. This is just a little something to show my appreciation for all you've done.
Thank you, Mr. Macy. Oh, that's very kind of you.
I didn't think you were that generous. That's a bit of money. What are you going to do with it?
Well, I have a friend, a doctor. He's been very kind to me. He needs an X-ray machine.
Oh, I don't think that's going to be enough. I'd better figure...
I'll make up the difference.
Buy it through the store and get 10% discount.
I can get it for cost.
Good night, Susan.
Now, would you like me to sing you a little goodnight song?
If you want to.
Doesn't your mother ever sing to you at night?
Mm-hmm. Why should she?
Oh, no reason. I just think it's kind of nice. Do you like market?
All right.
To market, to market, to buy a fat pig. Home again, jiggity-jig. To market, to buy a fat hog. Home again, jiggity.
Amazing. Do you happen to have a spare piece? Here goes. Oh.
How about a little game of checkers after lunch, eh?
Believe it's not today, Chris. I don't feel like it.
Oh, what's the matter?
Nothing.
Something is wrong. What is it?
Well, remember I was telling you how I like to play Santa Claus over at the Y on Christmas and give out packages to the young kids? Yeah. Well, I was telling that to Mr. Sawyer, see, and, well, he says that's very bad.
Sawyer, you mean,
That's the one. He's a psychologist, you know.
Well, that's a debatable point. Why is it bad, does he say?
Oh, sure, he says that guys who dress up like Santa Claus, see, and give presents away, do it because when they was young, they must have did something bad, and they feel guilty about it. So now they do something they think is good to make up for it, see? It's what he calls a guilt complex.
How old are you, Alfred?
17.
17. It doesn't seem to me that you've had time to be guilty of anything much except overeating.
It's nothing to laugh about, Chris. It's pretty serious, he says.
It's a lot of rubbish, Alfred. Don't listen to it.
Oh, he knows what he's talking about. He's been studying that stuff for a long time.
Oh. Well, what's the basis of this guilt complex you're supposed to have? Does he say that?
Well, he ain't found out yet. It's probably way down inside of me someplace, see? Maybe something that happened to me when I was a baby, he says. It takes time, but he'll do it, he says.
You mean you're going to him again?
Sure, I go every day for a little while after I finish my lunch. He don't soak me nothing. He's doing it for free because I'm an interesting case.
Yes. What else has he found wrong with you, Alfred? Anything else?
No. Oh, just that I hate my father. I didn't know it, but he says I do.
And he sees you every day?
Yeah, I just sit in a chair and say anything that comes into my head.
Excuse me, Alfred. A few things have just come into my head, and I'm going to say them.
What do you mean, bursting into my office like this?
Are you a licensed psychiatrist?
What business is it of yours?
I have great respect for psychiatry and great contempt for meddling amateurs who go around practicing it. You have no more right to analyze Alfred than a dentist has to remove a gallbladder.
I beg your pardon.
Your job here, I understand, is to give intelligence tests. Passing yourself off as a psychologist, you ought to be horsewhipped. Taking a normal, impressionable boy like Alfred and filling him up with complexes and phobias?
I think I'm better equipped to judge that than you are.
Just because the boy wants to be good and kind to children, you tell him he has a guilt complex.
Having the same delusion you couldn't possibly understand. The boy is definitely maladjusted, and I'm helping.
Maladjusted? You talk about maladjusted. Seems to me that the patient is running the clinic.
I won't step. Leave this office immediately.
Now, either you stop analyzing Alfred, or I go straight to Mr. Macy and tell him what a malicious, contemptible fraud you are.
Get out before I have you thrown out.
There's only one way to handle a man like you. You won't listen to reason. You're heartless. You have no humanity.
Are you going to leave?
Yes.
Something to him.
I tell you, we were merely talking. But the moment I mentioned Santa Claus, the moment I attacked his delusion, he became violent. I told you he had latent maniacal tendencies. Well, I think this proves it.
Maybe we'd better have Dr. Pierce give him another examination.
Dr. Pierce? He doesn't know anything about this sort of thing. He's a general practitioner.
You must admit this is rather serious. Perhaps we'd better get a competent psychiatrist.
But he's taken dozens of those examinations and passed them all 100%.
Well, in view of this, it's possible his condition has changed.
I don't think we can take any chances, really, I don't. I can't see any harm in it. If he passes the test, he can return to work immediately. And if he doesn't, Well, it's better we find out.
And you better have the examination right away before he tells before Mr. Macy finds out.
Oh, yes. Oh, my, yes. You explain to Mr. Kringle. After all, you're a friend of his.
I won't do it. I can't do it. I've grown very fond of him, and this would be like coming out and telling him that I thought he was insane.
Well, you don't call this acting normal, do you?
Of course I don't. But there are thousands of other old people who aren't normal either. This is going to hurt Chris very deeply, and I don't want to be the one to do it.
I don't think that'd be very fair to him. I'll tell him the truth. I always believe in being truthful with people.
If he sees me or you mention psychiatrist as more or less attacking his delusion again, he's apt to become violent.
But in front of the children? Oh, but that'd be terrible.
Well, you better get him out of the store on some other pretext. Then once outside, I'll explain it to him.
All right. If you think that it's better that way.
Please keep a straight line all day long to see Santa Claus.
Mr. Kringle.
Yep?
Mrs. Walker wanted me to tell you that we're going to take some publicity pictures this afternoon down at the City Hall. You and the mayor.
Cool. Like to meet you. A few things I'd like to talk over with. Oh, but I've made an appointment with Mr. Macy at 4 o'clock. I want to tell him about something.
Well, you'll be back in plenty of time. Now, there's a car waiting for you downstairs, and it's starting to drizzle. You need a coat. I'll get it.
Thanks. I'll be right with you. Just want to take care of a few of these kiddies first.
The second party shall, in consideration of the property, hereby agree to be conveyed by the first party to the second party. Excuse me, Gertrude. Telephone. Hello. Yes? Yes? Why, yes, we share an apartment together. Bellevue. But why, Doctor? What did he...
Oh, he's quite comfortable. He's going to be with us for a few days, and he was wondering if he could bring over his personal things. Yes. Yes, in view of his examination, I'm afraid I shall have to recommend commitment. Yes, I know, Mr. Gailey, but I'd rather speak to you in person.
I'll be right over, Doctor.
See the new patient.
Thanks.
Not at all.
Hello, Chris.
Fred.
Why'd you do it, Chris? You deliberately failed that examination, didn't you?
Why? Because the last few days I've had great hope. I had a feeling Doris was beginning to believe in me. And now I find out she was only just humoring me all the time.
But I just talked to her on the phone. She didn't know anything about her taking pictures with the mayor. That was Sawyer's idea.
Hmm? Well, I'm glad of that. But why didn't she come to me and explain the whole thing?
She didn't want to hurt you.
But only because I was a nice, kind old man and she was sorry for me.
That's not true.
Yes, it is. She had doubts. That's why she was just sorry. If you'd been dragged off here instead of me, she wouldn't have been sorry. She'd have been furious.
All right, she had doubts. Why not? She hasn't really believed in anything for years. You can't expect her to suddenly...
Oh, it's not just Doris. There's Mr. Sawyer. He's contemptible, dishonest, selfish, deceitful, vicious. And yet he's out there and I'm in here. He's called normal and I'm not. But if that's normal, I don't want it. That's why I answered the questions incorrectly.
But, Chris, you can't just think of yourself. What happens to you matters to a lot of other people. People like me who believe in what you stand for. And people like Susie who are just beginning to. You can't quit. You can't let them down.
No. I suppose I shouldn't.
Who knows? Maybe someday the Sawyers will be in here instead of out there.
You're right. I ought to be ashamed of myself. Even if we can't win, we can go down swinging. Let's get out of here.
Now, wait a minute. You're forgetting. You flunked your examination, but good.
Oh, yes. I forgot. I said Calvin Coolidge was the first president. I can imagine what they're thinking of me for saying that. But you'll get me out of this. You'll think of something.
It's not going to be easy, Chris.
Oh, it will be for you. I believe you're the greatest lawyer since Darryl.
Just a second, Chris. You're putting me in an awful spot.
But I believe in you. You can't get me down.
But you don't understand it. I'll do everything I can, Chris.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
That's a lot of nonsense. Danger is my foot. I don't care if he failed 10 examinations. You had no right to do it. Now you get the case dropped tomorrow, or you might have another lump to match the one that Chris gave you.
Yes, Mr. Massey.
Read all this.
Take my word for it. Just routine commitment papers, cut and dried. The man calls himself Chris Kringle. Thinks he's Santa Claus.
Oh. Come in.
Mr. Gailey to see you, Your Honor. He represents Mr. Kringle.
Better show him in.
Good morning. Your Honor, there seems to be undue haste in this case. I wish to protect my client's rights, as I'm sure you do.
Of course.
If Your Honor please, I request a formal hearing to which I may bring witnesses.
I thought you said this was cut and dry.
That's what I was told. I didn't know anything about a protest.
Of course, you may sign the commitment papers now if you wish, Your Honor, but I shall bring in a habeas corpus this afternoon.
There's no point in signing. We'll have a hearing on Monday morning at 10 o'clock.
Thank you, Your Honor. Good day. Thank you.
That man, I heard him say something about Mr. Kringle before. Who is he?
His name is Gailey, Kringle's lawyer. Probably grabbed the case to get some cheap publicity.
Publicity? Oh, we can't have that, Mr. Mara. As a matter of fact, Mr. Macy would rather drop the whole thing right now.
Well, it can't be done. It's too late now. Kringle has been examined by psychiatrists of a city hospital. It has to go through the regular routine.
No, we must avoid publicity. I represent Mr. Macy. My name's Sawyer.
Oh, so you're Sawyer.
Yes. Now, regarding this Kringle matter, we're very anxious to avoid publicity of any kind.
Naturally.
So, if you would agree to put this matter through quietly, I'm sure we could find some generous way of expressing our appreciation.
Very interesting.
Then you'll cooperate?
Very interesting. Publicity. You know, that's not a bad idea. You know, if I'm going to win this case, I'm going to have public opinion and plenty of it. And publicity's just the way to do it. Thanks, Mr. Sawyer.
Oh, Mr. Gailey. Mr. Gailey.
standing right by the police.
What they're making such a fuss about. After all, he's an old man.
How are you feeling lately, Henry? You look a little run down.
Me? Why? Well, I feel fine. Never better. Why don't you go and see the doc? Take a few weeks off. Go fishing. Go hunting. Go any place.
Why should I?
Because this Kringle case is dynamite. Let some judge handle it that isn't coming up for re-election.
I can't do that.
Henry, listen, I'm no legal brain trust. I don't know a habeas from a corpus, but I do know politics. That's my record. I got you elected, didn't I? And I'm going to try to get you reelected.
I know, Charlie. Now, don't misunderstand me. I appreciate everything that you've done for me.
And I'm telling you to get off this case.
But why?
Because you're a regular Pontius Pilate the minute you start. That's why.
Oh, I don't believe it. I'm an honest man, and nobody's going to hold it against me for doing my duty as I see it.
Good night, Terry. Good night, Alice. Now, straight to bed. I promised your mother you'd be in bed by 8 o'clock, and it's way past.
Aren't you coming, too?
Mm-hmm. I'll be up in a minute to tuck you in. Now, scoot.
Now, how about a great big kiss for Grandpa, hmm? Fine way to treat their grandfather. No hug, no kiss, no anything.
I don't blame them. Any man who puts Santa Claus on trial for lunacy.
See what I mean?
Hey.
Don't worry about me. I've got the best lawyer in the world.
How long do you think this will take?
Maybe a week.
A week? That seems impossible. All that has to be done is...
Look, you don't think that lawyer's going to be stupid enough to let him admit anything, do you? He's naturally going to deny everything. And I'll bring witnesses, and he'll bring witnesses.
Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. All persons having business with the special term, Part 3 of the Supreme Court, held in and for the County of New York. Draw near and give your attendance, and ye shall be heard.
Matter of Kris Kringle, Your Honor. The commitment papers are before you. Your Honor, please, I should like to call the first witness. Mr. Kringle, will you take the stand?
Good morning, Your Honor.
You do solemnly swear that the testimony you are about to give in the cause before this court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do. Before you begin, Mr. Mara, I want to explain to the witness that this is a hearing, not a trial. Mr. Kringle, you don't have to answer any questions against your wishes or even testify at all.
We have no objection, Your Honor.
Oh, I'll be glad to answer any questions that I can.
What is your name?
Kris Kringle.
Where do you live?
That's what this hearing will decide. A very sound answer, Mr. Kringle.
Do you believe that you're Santa Claus?
Of course.
State rest, Your Honor.
Well, Mr. Gailey,
Do you wish to cross-examine the witness? I believe he was employed to play Santa Claus. Perhaps he didn't understand the question correctly.
Oh, I understood the question perfectly, Your Honor.
No further questions at this time.
Thank you.
In view of this statement, do you still wish to put in a defense, young man?
I do, Your Honor. I'm fully aware of my client's opinions. In fact, that's the entire case against him. All these complicated tests and reports boil down to this. Mr. Kringle is not sane because he believes himself to be Santa Claus.
An entirely logical and reasonable assumption, I'm afraid.
It would be if the clerk here, or Mr. Mara, or I, believed that we were Santa Claus.
Anyone who thinks he's Santa Claus is not sane.
Not necessarily. You believe yourself to be Judge Harper, yet no one questions your sanity because you are Judge Harper.
I know all about myself, young man. Mr. Kringle is the subject of this hearing.
Yes, Your Honor. And if he is the person he believes himself to be, just as you are, then he's just as sane.
Granted, but he isn't.
Oh, but he is, Your Honor.
Is what?
I intend to prove that Mr. Kringle is Santa Claus.
He's crazy, too.
Reserved a regular table at Luigi's. We're going to celebrate.
What are we celebrating?
Read all about it. Danny throws bombshell in New York Supreme Court.
Yes, I read that.
Oh, I didn't see this. Front page. Good.
You're not serious about this.
Of course I am.
But you can't possibly prove that he's Santa Claus.
Why not? You saw Macy and Gimble shaking hands. That wasn't possible either, but it happened.
Honestly,
it's the best defense I can use. Completely logical and completely unexpected.
And completely idiotic. What about your bosses, Hayslip and McKenzie and the rest of them? What do they say?
That I am jeopardizing the prestige and dignity of an old established law firm. And either I drop this impossible case immediately, or they will drop me.
See?
I've been to it. I quit.
Fred, you didn't.
Of course I did. I can't let Chris down. He needs me, and all the rest of us need him.
Look, darling, he's a nice old man, and I admire you for wanting to help him. But you've got to be realistic and face facts. You can't just throw your career away because of a sentimental whim.
But I am not throwing my career away.
But if Hayslip feels that way, so will every other law firm in town.
I'm sure they will. Then I'll open my own office.
And what kind of cases will you get?
Oh, probably a lot of people like Chris that are being pushed around. That's the only fun in law anyway. And I promise you, if you believe in me and have faith in me, everything will... You don't have any faith in me, do you?
It's not a question of faith, it's just common sense.
Faith is believing in things when common sense tells you not to... Don't you see, it's not just Chris that's on trial. It's everything he stands for. It's kindness,
Fred.
And joy, and love, and all the other intangibles.
Oh, Fred, you're talking like a child. You're living in a realistic world, and those lovely intangibles of yours are attractive but not worth very much. You don't get ahead that way.
That all depends on what you call getting ahead. Evidently, you and I have different definitions.
These last few days, we've talked about some wonderful plans. And then you go on an idealistic binge. You give up your job, you throw away all your security, and then you expect me to be happy about it.
Yes, I guess I expected too much. Look, Doris, someday you're going to find out that your way of facing this realistic world just doesn't work. And when you do, don't overlook those lovely intangibles. You'll discover they're the only things that are worthwhile.
These reporters make me look like a sadistic monster who likes to drown cats and tear the wings off butterflies. Why, this old man is...
Oh, honey, go in and get Mother's scissors, will you? They're in the bedroom. That's a good boy. I don't want you to discuss this case in front of him.
would break his heart. But while we're on the subject, I agree with the reporters. Mr. Kringle seems to be a nice old man, and I don't see why you have to keep persecuting him.
Firstly, I am not persecuting him. I am prosecuting him. And secondly, I like the old man, too. Wish I'd never gotten into this. But it's too late now, and there's nothing I can do about it. It's up to the state of New York, and I am just their duly appointed legal representative. Kringle has been declared a menace to society by competent doctors, and it's my duty to protect the state of New York and see that he's put away. No matter what they may say about me, I've got to do it.
Sometimes I wish I'd married a butcher or a plumber.
Well, my dear, if I lose this case, it's very possible that you'll get your wish.
Stores in New York City?
The biggest.
Mr. Macy, if you recognize the gentleman seated there, will you tell us who he is?
Chris Kringle.
Your employee, is he not?
Yes.
Do you believe him to be truthful?
Yes.
Do you believe him to be of sound mind?
I certainly do.
Mr. Macy, you're under oath. Do you really believe that this man is Santa Claus?
Well, I... Well, he gives every indication.
I asked you, Mr. Macy, do you really believe that this man is Santa Claus?
I do.
You graduate from a correspondence school, you're fired.
Your Honor, I object to this testimony. It's ridiculous, irrelevant, and immaterial. Mr. Gailey is making a circus out of this court. There is no such person as Santa Claus, and everybody knows it.
Your Honor, I submit it's purely a matter of opinion. Can Mr. Mara offer any proof that there is no Santa Claus?
No, and I do not intend to. This is not a nursery. It's the New York State Supreme Court, and I'll not waste this court's time with such childish nonsense.
Mr. Mara seems to have appointed himself the judge here, Your Honor. He's now ruling on what testimony I may introduce.
Your Honor, we request an immediate ruling from this court. Is there or is there not a Santa Claus?
Well... The court will take a short recess to consider the matter.
I don't care what you do with old Whisker Puss, but if you go back in there and rule that there's no Santa Claus, you better start looking for that chicken farm right now. Why, we won't even be able to put you in the primaries.
But, Charlie, listen to reason. I'm a responsible judge. I've taken an oath. How can I seriously rule that there is a Santa Claus?
Why don't you All right. You go back and tell him that the New York State Supreme Court rules there's no Santa Claus. It's all over the papers. The kids read it and they don't hang up their stockings. Now, what happens to all the toys that are supposed to be in those stockings? Nobody buys them. The toy manufacturers are going to like that. So they have to lay off a lot of their employees. Union employees. Now you got the CIO and the AFL against you. And they're going to adore you for it. And they're going to say it with votes. Oh, and the department stores are going to love you too. And the Christmas card makers. And the candy companies. Oh, Henry, you're going to be an awful popular fella. And what about the Salvation Army? Why, they got a Santa Claus on every corner, and they're taking a fortune. But you go ahead, Henry. You do it your way. You go on back in there and tell them that you rule there's no Santa Claus. Go on.
But if you do, remember this. You can count on getting just two votes, your own and that district attorney's out there.
The district attorney's a Republican.
All right.
Before making a ruling, this court has consulted the highest authority available. The question of Santa Claus seems to be largely a matter of opinion. Many people firmly believe in him. Others do not. The tradition of American justice demands a broad and unprejudiced view of such a controversial matter. This court, therefore, intends to keep an open mind. We shall hear evidence on either side.
He's crazy, too.
Your Honor, the burden of proof for this ridiculous contention clearly rests with my opponent. Can he produce any evidence to support his views?
If Your Honor please, I can. Will Thomas Mara please take the stand?
Who, me?
Thomas Mara, Jr.
Hello, Daddy.
Tommy, you know the difference between telling the truth and telling a lie, don't you?
Gosh, everybody knows you shouldn't tell a lie, especially in court.
See, Mr. Gailey,
do you believe in Santa Claus, Tommy?
Sure I do. He gave me a brand new flexible flyer sled last year, and this year...
And, what does he look like?
There he is, sitting there.
Your Honor, I protest.
Overruled.
Tell me, Tommy, why are you so sure this is Santa Claus?
Because my daddy told me so. Didn't you, Daddy?
You believe your daddy, don't you, Tommy? He's a very honest man.
Of course he is. My daddy wouldn't tell me anything that wasn't so. Would you, Dad?
Thank you, Tommy.
Goodbye, Daddy.
Your Honor.
Don't forget a real official football helmet.
Don't worry, Tommy. You'll get it.
Your Honor, the state of New York concedes the existence of Santa Claus. But in so conceding, we ask that Mr. Gailey cease presenting personal opinion as evidence. The state could bring in hundreds of witnesses with opposite opinions. But it's our desire to shorten this hearing rather than prolong it. I therefore request that Mr. Gailey now submit authoritative proof that Mr. Kringle is the one and only Santa Claus.
Your point's well taken, Mr. Mara. I'm afraid we must agree. Mr. Gailey, are you prepared to show that Mr. Kringle is Santa Claus on the basis of competent authority?
Not at this time, Your Honor. I ask for an adjournment until tomorrow.
The court stands adjourned till tomorrow afternoon at 3:00.
Well, I guess that's that.
There's a way out. There's got to be. Well, it's hard to explain. You see, they're having, well, sort of a trial about him.
You mean like for a murder?
Oh, no, no, it isn't that kind of a trial. It's just because he says he's Santa Claus.
But I've got a feeling he is Santa Claus, Mother.
Some people don't believe that. That's why they're having this...
But he's so kind and nice and jolly. He's not like anyone else. He must be Santa.
I think perhaps you're right, Susie.
Is Mr. Kringle sad now, Mother?
I'm afraid he is. I'm sure he misses you and...
Then I'm going to write him a letter right now and cheer him up.
North Pole, South Pole, and every other place. Here's a kid writes, Chris Kringle, New York County Courthouse. Can you beat that?
The kid's right. Huh? They got him on trial down there. He claims that he's Santa Claus, and the DA claims that he's nuts. Yeah, read it for yourself. Right on the front page.
Hey, Lou, how many Santa Claus letters we got down at the dead letter office?
I don't know. There must be about 50,000 of them. Bags and bags all over the joint, and there's more coming in every day.
Hey, Lou.
Yeah.
It'd be kind of nice to get rid of them, wouldn't it, huh?
Yeah, but... Hey, that's a wonderful idea,
hey. I mean, after all, why should we be bothered with all that stuff, huh? Why don't you get a couple of trucks up here, big ones, right away? Load them with all that Santa Claus mail and deliver it to Mr. Kringle down at the courthouse. Let somebody else worry about it, huh? Hey, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells.
Fred.
Chris, I'm afraid I've got bad news. I've tried every way to get some competent authority. I've wired the governor, the mayor. I even...
This is worth more to me than all the governors and mayors in the world.
It's all over, George. Look at him. He hasn't got a thing.
Has yet to offer one concrete piece of evidence to substantiate this preposterous claim. Not one competent authoritative proof that this man is Santa Claus. In view of these facts, and especially since today is Christmas Eve, we're naturally all anxious to get to our homes. I ask that you sign the commitment papers without further delay.
Mr. Gailey, have you anything further to offer?
Yes, I have, Your Honor. I'd like to submit the following facts and evidence. It concerns the Post Office Department, an official agency of the United States government. The Post Office Department was created by the Second Continental Congress on July 26, 1776. The first Postmaster General was Benjamin Franklin. The Post Office Department is one of the largest business concerns in the world. Last year, under Robert Hannigan, it did a gross business of $1,112,877,174.
Your Honor, I'm sure we're all gratified to know that the Post Office Department is doing so nicely, but it hardly has any bearing on this case.
It has a great deal, Your Honor, if I may be allowed to proceed.
By all means, Mr. Gailey.
Your Honor, the figures I have just quoted indicate an efficiently run organization. Furthermore, the United States postal laws and regulations make it a criminal offense to willfully misdirect mail or intentionally deliver it to the wrong party. Consequently, the department uses every possible precaution.
Your Honor, the state of New York is second to none in its admiration of the Post Office Department. It is efficient, authoritative, and prosperous. We are very happy to concede Mr. Gailey's claims.
For the record, Mr. Mara?
For the record. Anything to get on with this case.
Then, Your Honor, I want to introduce these pieces of evidence.
I'll take them, please.
I have here three letters. They're addressed simply Santa Claus. No other address whatsoever. Yet these letters have just now been delivered to Mr. Kringle by bona fide employees of the Post Office. I offer them as positive proof that a competent...
Three letters, Your Honor, are hardly positive proof. But I understand the Post Office receives thousands of these letters every year.
I have further exhibits, Your Honor, but I hesitate to produce them.
Oh, I'm sure we'll be very happy to see them.
Yes. Produce them, Mr. Gailey. Put them here on my desk.
But, Your Honor...
Put them here on the desk. Put them...
Yes, Your Honor. Addressed to Santa Claus. The Post Office has delivered them. Therefore, the Post Office Department, a branch of the federal government, recognizes this man, Kris Kringle, to be the one and only Santa Claus.
Since the United States government declares this man to be Santa Claus, this court will not dispute it. Case dismissed.
I've got to get that football helmet.
Thank you so much, Your Honor, and a very Merry Christmas to you.
Thank you, Mr. Kringle. And the same to you.
Thank you.
Chris.
I had to wait to tell you. I got your note. It made me very happy.
Oh, I'm so glad.
We're having a big Christmas party at the Brooks home tomorrow morning. Breakfast, a beautiful tree, and... I'd like to have you and Susan.
Oh, thank you. I can't think of anyone I'd rather spend Christmas with. Would you like to come to dinner tonight?
Tonight? Oh, I can't. It's Christmas Eve.
Oh, I forgot.
Bye.
Thank you. my assistant, Alfred, Mr. Mason.
Merry Christmas, Alfred.
Mr.
Shellhammer, there's something here I'd like to show you.
Mr. Mason.
Chris, all I can say is the state Supreme Court declared you to be Santa Claus, and personally and professionally, I agree with them.
But there are lots of presents there for you, darling.
Not the one I wanted. Not the one Mr. Kringle was going to get for me.
What was that?
It doesn't matter. I didn't get it. I knew it wouldn't be here, but I thought there'd be a letter or something telling me.
I don't suppose you even want to talk to me.
Something about a present.
Yes, I know. I'm sorry, Susie. I tried my best, but...
You couldn't get it because you're not Santa Claus, that's why. You're just a nice old man with whiskers, like my mother said. And I shouldn't have believed you.
I was wrong when I told you that, Susie. You must believe in Mr. Kringle and keep right on doing it. Must have faith in him.
But he didn't get me the... That doesn't make sense, Mommy.
Faith is believing in things when common sense tells you not to.
Huh?
I mean, just because things don't turn out the way you want them to the first time, you've still got to believe in people. I found that out.
You mean it's like, if at first you don't succeed, try again. I thought so.
May I drive you home?
Thank you.
Now, if you'll go this way, you'll miss a lot of traffic. I've written it all down. So you go along Maplewood until you come to Ashley.
I believe. It's silly, but I believe.
Thanks, Chris. I'll be fine.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you. And to you, my dear. And many of them. Goodbye, my friend.
Goodbye, Susie. This must be the turn here. That's right, Ashley. Now you go straight for four blocks.
Sign outside said it's for sale. We can't let her down.